welcome to a very special show of Cover Story, where I am in conversation with two senior political leaders, Manish Tewari from the Congress and Pavan Varma from the JDU. We're going to be discussing various issues that are dominating the political narrative of the day. Manish, to begin with you, we've seen, let's first talk about the budget. You know, since there is nobody from the BJP, we're going to keep it non-partisan. But there is a feeling that the middle class is feeling alienated by this government.
Well, Priya, it's very difficult to be objective about the budget because it is not only the middle class which has been alienated. This government over the past 44 months has succeeded in alienating almost every class of people. The feeling on the street is that the Prime Minister and the NDA-BJP government has taken people for a ride. And there's nothing worse than people feeling cheated. And, you know, it starts off primarily because of the host of promises made in the run-up to the 2014 campaign. Acche din, 15 lakhs, you know, jobs. And you
before
have...
Before you kick off the 2019 campaign, I just focus on the middle class part.
So therefore, there is this growing anger. That not only have they not delivered on the promises, but they have now tried to add insult to injury by saying that frying fritters is respectable employment. So therefore, you know, when you actually insult the educated young person, and rather than giving him the job that you promised him, you tell him that, you know, go fry fritters. It's almost like telling somebody go fly a kite. And so therefore, that's why I'm saying it's not about only losing the middle. Yes, they have lost the middle, demonetization, GST, all that has impacted the middle class, I think, the maximum. But most importantly is this feeling, which is now growing at a very rapid pace, that this government and the Prime Minister have taken us for a ride.
But Pavan, can this government, you've written a book on the middle class also, can the government, because Modi came to power riding on a lot of middle class goodwill, can they afford to ignore us just because we don't go out and vote?
First, let me say to you, Priya, because you wanted this to be a non-partisan debate.
Since we don't have a BJP person.
Even otherwise, in this country, there is a tradition of a non-partisan debate where you can talk of public issues without necessarily taking enforced sides. And from that point of view, I'll say that the job of any finance minister is not an easy one. Because as was the saying in the last years of the Mughal rule, yak anar sad bimar. One pomegranate, 100 ill men. You have to satisfy many competing constituencies when resources are not elastic. The second fundamental question is that if in the last year of your tenure in government, until the next general election, does that budget really have that transformational value as earlier budgets have? Because in a sense, you are already in a lead-up to the elections. And you have therefore a very little maneuvering scope to do something transformational or foundational. Now, given these constraints, I think that as far as the middle class is concerned, first and foremost, the size of the middle class in India, especially across urban India and the upper crust of rural India, must be in the vicinity, in my opinion, of 400 million to 500 million people today. It's an exceptionally aspirational class. It's a class that wants actually upward mobility, in a sense to move beyond mullahs and mahants and get on with their life, a better life, a better job, security, jobs, school for the children, health facilities, and to move up the ladder. Now, this is that middle class. I think the middle class has perennially this feeling that somehow between the very rich and the very poor, because we are not a large vote bank, we are being ignored. It's not only with this budget, but it has been a feeling. I don't think that's true because it's a very large middle class now, and certainly Mr. Narendra Modi came primarily riding on the support that this very vocal, articulate, influential class gave him, which had a ripple effect down the line.
Right.
Now, this particular middle class, I think, is feeling somewhat disappointed by the budget today. Because one of the things is jobs. Jobs go to the relatively educated, which can come from the entire spectrum of the middle class. I was surprised the other day, and Manish may bear me out on this, that the government has actually come out with a paper called the Bose and Bose paper, which says that 7 million jobs have been created.
They are taking the Mudra schemes
in the, formal sector on the basis of the Provident Fund EPFs. Now, the normal ratio in an economy is that if 7 million jobs have been created in the formal sector, the ratio is 1:2. 14 million jobs must have been created then in the informal sector. Collectively, that adds to 21 million jobs. At any given time in India, there are 12 to 15 million people seeking a job. So, are we facing a situation of overemployment? I think there is something wrong in these statistics. Secondly, people in the middle class want to start a business, want to be entrepreneurs, make money on their own if they are not getting a job as a salaried job. I think there again, while the government's intentions may have been to start up India, stand up India, rise India and so on and so forth, we must remember that although we've gone up a few notches on the ease of doing business, even that report which puts us up points out to the great areas where we are lagging unacceptably behind. For instance, we are out of 190 countries at 156 on starting a business. I mean, that low in the pyramid.
Okay.
So, obviously, if you want to start a job, it's not easy. And enforcement of contracts, we are at 164. In getting a job, there is a problem. On getting tax relief, I think the middle class was disappointed because they got a standard deduction. Slight
which doesn't really work out on paper.
But they got a 1% increase in the educational cess, so it didn't amount to much.
Right.
There was some relief for senior citizens, but cumulatively it doesn't. It has to be seen whether the 5% reduction in the MSME, sector, the small and medium business sector, whether that 5% reduction is sufficient to be enough of an incentive to break the current logjam of a somewhat moribund economy. So, these are the challenges. I think in that sense, the middle class is disappointed because it got neither tax relief nor any real hope in the areas that they were looking for.
That is true. But also, Manish, is the middle class always let down by its messiahs? You know, whether it was earlier Rajiv Gandhi, VP Singh, to an extent Manmohan Singh, now of course Narendra Modi. Do we choose the wrong heroes?
You see, there is a danger and you are absolutely correct. There is a danger in alienating the middle class. Often what happens is when people come to power, they come to power riding on the goodwill of the middle class. And when they are in office, they are generally dismissive about the middle class. They say that the middle class doesn't matter. We'll look at farmers. We look at, you know, other more organized constituencies. And herein lies the fallacy, because if you travel back in time, you talked about former Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi. He was the darling of the middle classes till that point in time in 1987, when a problem started occurring. VP Singh was actually a creation of the middle classes till the point in time that he decided to come in and then implement the Mandal Commission report in the manner in which he implemented it, which led to a wave of immolations across the country. And eventually, Mr. VP Singh's government became history. And so on and so forth. Even when the Congress goes from 140 seats to 206 seats in the 2009 elections, you actually carry every city from Thiruvananthapuram to Jammu with you. And then when that entire conspiracy of sleaze was built up against the Congress which has been now punctured by the 2G judgment to some extent, the first constituency that you lost was the Indian middle class.
Right.
So therefore, there is a political cost which every political party and every government has paid for alienating the middle class, and that is without exception. I just wanted to respond to one thing which, you know, Pavan had said about ease of doing business. Right? Now, yesterday the Prime Minister also in the House said that, you know, as Indians we should be very proud of the fact that if we are ranked better on the index of the ease of doing business. First of all, that index itself is under review. Right? The World Bank is in the process of reviewing that index.
But he did say the Congress will find fault with therefore,
is it appropriate for the Prime Minister to really be relying upon data which itself is being reviewed by the authority which has put out the data? Number two, which is more serious, if ease of doing business had actually improved in India, and Pavan pointed out certain concrete instances where we are actually lagging behind, then you wouldn't have had a situation whereby close to a million high net worth individuals have become non-resident Indians in the last 5 years. Today there's a report, yesterday there was a report in the Quint, which I have tweeted. And that report points out to the fact that dollar billionaires, or actually people who have a substantial amount of personal wealth, what are called high net worth individuals, have left the shores of this country in droves. So either there is a problem that you have been extremely punitive in the manner in which you actually wanted to enforce your ditkaat, or there is a feeling that it's become very difficult to do business out here. So in any sense of the word, you know, if you look at it from the point of view of broken promises, if you look at it from the point of view of actually really easing the entire atmosphere or the environment of doing business, the middle class has been, without exception, completely shortchanged.
Okay, one last question on the middle class before we move on to other topics is, what can the Prime Minister do to win back this class? Because, you know, this is really, he's come up on the support of the middle class.
You see, it's important to remember that the Prime Minister initially won the support of the middle class on the clarion call of hope. Because the last years of the UPA 2 government were perceived to be won, overridden by scams and paralyzed in terms of governance, or at least a great deal of drift. And here came a person on a white stallion who said, what this country needs is decisive leadership, and I will make a transformational change. And even the slogan, Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, seemed to raise the hope that all of this will be achieved in a milieu of social stability and harmony. Now, certainly, that hope to some extent has been belied. There have been beneficiaries, there have been successful schemes. I particularly want to underline the Ujjavala scheme, which has, I think, benefited rural women. There have been other schemes which have been relatively more successful. But there are two factors which even the middle class must take note of, however discontented they may feel. The agony is far greater for the people below them. The rural distress, especially of the poor, is very high, and absolute poverty is still a great bane for this country, where people are actually living on one meal a day. And the global hunger index, as compared to the ease of doing business, we've gone down very many ranks on it. That means more people are going hungry to bed at night.
Yeah.
So there is a very large number of people who are suffering more than the middle class. I think that we must remember that.
But should we squeeze the middle class to deal with them? Why couldn't, you know, he found other ways in the economy to announce his, you know, SOPs, freebies, the other ways, instead of just tapping the one class that is being tapped again?
You could argue that you could do more for the middle class. But I began whatever I was saying by saying that resources are not infinitely elastic. You have a kitty, and actually, if you take fixed costs that the government has to bear, there's very little maneuvering space. You could do very large disinvestment. You could take away the land pools owned by certain PSUs and dispose them off. But I think by the last year of a governance cycle of a five-year period in which governments are in power, the scope for a great deal of foundational restructuring becomes a little more difficult.
Okay, we're going to take a break. I'll come back to you, but after a short break. So stay with us. Hello and welcome back to Cover Story. We are in conversation with Manish Tewari and Pavan Varma. Manish, before the break, Pavan was speaking about, how we need to actually balance the budget, and there's very little room for the government to play around with in this last year.
Well, there are always competing priorities on the budget. Hmm. Whether it is the first year of any government or it is the last year, there is this constant attrition of resources qua priorities. So therefore, that's not something which this finance minister has had to deal with, that every finance minister in every country has to deal with. But to the point that you were making about, you could have taxed the rich. Hmm. Now, you have a strange situation whereby you bring down corporate income tax from 30% to 25%. Now, you are saying that you are doing it for companies with a turnover of 200 crores, which means 99.9% or 99% of the industry. Well, very fair. But then if you could bring down corporate income tax, you could have brought down personal income tax for the salaried people from 30% to 25%, from 20% to 15%, and from 10% to 7.5%. So therefore, if you were giving concessions to corporates, you could have given concessions to salaried people. And
may I just add here, just one word, because actually if you factor in inflation, just take two, LPG and take fuel prices, petrol and diesel. Hmm. In 1 year, the burden on the middle class has gone up very substantially.
Yes, which has not been passed on.
And then the real dichotomy is that the economy is not growing. And the economy is not growing because, as Pavan was pointing out in one of his speeches earlier, that there is a direct correlation between social harmony and economic development. You see, Donald Rumsfeld is not everybody's favorite person, but Donald Rumsfeld, when he was the US Defense Secretary, had made a very prophetic comment. He said, money is a coward and money will go to the safest harbor. Unfortunately, in the last 44 months, you've created an atmosphere in this country whereby the nation is on an edge. Whether it is cow vigilantism, it is love jihad, it is various other forms of social tensions, which have been deliberately orchestrated, not by the fringe, but by the mainstream itself, calling itself the fringe. And the casualty of that has been economic development, and that's why in the last year especially was after 1991 the lowest year in terms of investment into the Indian economy by domestic corporates.
But I thought, Pavan, if you fix the economy, then everything else is forgiven.
Well, I can say that a lot of social instability, which is undesirable, can be tolerated a little more, especially by a majority community or by the average citizen, if there is economic buoyancy. If everybody is earning more, the economy is doing well, you can get away with it. But if your business is closed or if you are not getting jobs, then whipping up social instability beyond a point becomes counterproductive. As I once wrote a column about that, you can't posit in the case of Hindus Lakshmi versus Ram. If Lakshmi, who stands for prosperity and all well-being, is being affected, you can't expect the same person
to then
carry a brick to build a Ram Mandir. He may or she may do it, but certainly it creates that much more difficulty. So that is one part of the issue. What we are seeing today, and especially after certain statements we have seen by members of parliament of the BJP, that Muslims should go back now to Pakistan and Bangladesh, I am against all forms of appeasement. And if there have been excesses in the case of appeasement, they need to be rectified. But statements like this have nothing to do with countering appeasement. They are an open incitement from my point of view to communal hatred, and actually should attract the provisions of sedition. Are you advocating a second partition of the country? And in such a milieu, do you think that investment in the long run will continue to come? That companies will invest hoping that there will be a secure and harmonious atmosphere? I think this factor, and Manish mentioned it and we were discussing it, the correlation between economic development and social harmony is very strong. And I think all governments need to remember.
But yet your party is supporting this government.
We are supporting the government as part of the NDA. But on individual issues, and let me name the issue of secularism or rural distress, I think the JDU has stood very strongly for ameliorating the deteriorating condition of farmers, and has even pointed out that you can't win an election by ignoring the very large agrarian sector and the transparent distress that you see there. And on the issue of secularism, there is no question of a compromise. When I say secularism, I don't like the fact that people don't like the word, but I don't want to use it. All I'm saying is that this country, if it wants to remain united, as we've succeeded in doing, in spite of all the prophecies of doom, we must be the composite, multicultural, plural society that we have always been. If not for principle, then for expediency.
On that note, can I bring up the Ram temple?
Sorry, you were saying something. Go ahead.
Yeah, the Ram temple is also going on in the court.
Look, Priya, on a lighter note, if the discourse in the country would have actually remained between Lord Ram and Goddess Lakshmi, which is materialism, whether it should or can coexist with virtuousness.
In Hinduism, everything coexists. Maryada Purushottam, Ram is a beloved god, but so is Lakshmi.
That's right. That's exactly what I'm saying. But unfortunately, what has happened is that you've brought the discourse down to Sarupnakha. So therefore, if you degenerate the discourse to such an extent, you know, you're obviously trying to create unnecessary tensions where they don't exist. And this is reflective really of a mindset. Because if you extrapolate to it to what's been going on in the last 44 months, there has been a concerted, orchestrated attempt to keep this nation on an edge, you know, by precipitating and exacerbating social tensions. And going back to the issue of the Ram temple, it's being agitated in a court of law. And ultimately, what the court decides, you know, once you've decided that the whole question would be judicially adjudicated, whatever the Supreme Court decides will be binding on everybody.
We have always maintained, either through a judicial verdict or by mutual agreement of all concerned stakeholders.
And that is something the BJP is also saying that we would abide by. So that is something the NDA line, something you agree on with the BJP. But on that note, I think we've covered a vast area of subjects from Goddess Lakshmi to Sarupnakha. I think we've covered it all. But that's it. Thank you, gentlemen, for talking to me. And well, that's it for this week. Thank you for watching this show. We'll see you again same time next week.